Dr. Tozer is reading from Philippians chapter 3, verse 10.
And then in verse 10, that I may know him. Now, tonight I want to talk about this, that I may know him. In the first place, I believe that God created the heaven and the earth and all things that are therein. Everybody that believes this is good, say amen. I believe that God made the heaven and the earth and all things that are therein. And I'm going to believe that he made all living creatures. And he made each one the kind of life for your good. The kind of life that he chose for us. And then he adjusted that kind of life to an environment which he chose for us. And as long as each living creature stays in its own environment and lives the kind of life God gave it, that creature fulfills the purpose for which it is made. And God being who it is, there can be nothing said of any creature higher than this. He fulfills that for which God made him. Now that's all. You can't go higher than that. You can put statues in the park. You can write their names on the walls of famous buildings. You can give them prizes of all sorts, Nobel prizes and Pulitzer prizes and every kind of prize. But you can canonize them if you wish. But when it's all been told, all been said, you cannot say any more of any creature than this. God made him, gave him a certain kind of life, gave him an environment to inhabit. And he has lived in that environment and in relaxed confidence has lived the kind of life God gave him. Now that's all. The angels and archangels and seraphim and cherubim and saints and prophets can't go any further than that. Now, it says here that the angels, it's not their first estate, but left their own habitation. God had reserved in everlasting things under darkness, under the judgment of the great day. Here we see a certain order of beings, or a certain number of beings of an order, that left their first estate. That is, they left the place for which they had been created. And anyone, anybody, any intelligent creature, any moral creature anywhere, to leave the proper sphere and its state, will know only in this creature and the pain. Because they are not fulfilling the end for which they were created. Now that I say generally of any living being anywhere. Incidentally, brothers and sisters, you and I are willingly poverty stricken because we're scared sick. We're afraid to use our religious imagination and we're afraid to believe what the Bible teaches us. The Bible talks about angels and archangels, at least one, and the seraphs and the cherubim and the watchers and the holy ones and the principalities and powers. And you and I insist on people, that's all. We are afraid to rise and let our faith-filled imagination encompass the wonder of the filled universe, filled with beings. Now, God created man in his own image, and of no other creature is he spoken. I cannot find in the scriptures where God said he ever created the seraph in his image, nor a cherubim, with all of his faces and his wings, nor an angel or archangel or principality or power, but it says that God made man in his image. God said affectionately, let us make man in our own image, for in the image of God created him. And building through the best of life, and man became a living soul. So that man, now here it is, we can take this out, misquote it, misquote it, and make a radical out of me if you want to do it. But I'm sure you won't. But as originally created, man was more like God than any other creature that ever was created. As originally created, man was more like God, because of no other creature did God say that he made them in his own image. And the wise old German Christian said this: there is nothing in the universe so much like God as human soul. Now, of course, he took for granted and meant that man's soul is sinful and lost. And in that sense, sin is not like God, and the soul that sinneth it shall die. But there is something basic in human nature and in the soul of man that can become more like God than anything else in the universe. I wish you could believe that. I wish that we could accept that as a part of our creed and not be afraid that if we state it and say we believe it, somebody will charge us with believing man's all right. Man's not all right. Man's a fallen creature. Man went down like an automobile that left the highway, had a curve, and went over a gully down in among the rocks. And man is not all right. Man is lost. Man is not damned. I heard a preacher this afternoon talking about my poor, lost, damned soul. No, no, never call yourself damned, brother. You're lost if you're not converted. You're lost if you're not damned. That's another thing altogether. But God created man to know him. And he created man to know him in a sense and to a degree which no other creature can know God. The creatures that are in the presence of God may not know God as well as the man soul which God has made in his image. Don't you see? Don't you see that there has to be a degree of light there which enables a man to know God? Don't you see that the cat there under your table or the dog there lying on the rug, you put a record on, you put on something by Mozart or Beethoven, and he'll never even open a CD eye because there's nothing in that cat nature that can understand Beethoven or Mozart. Put on, as you have at home, some of the fine records of London, the great choir there singing Christmas carols. Well, no dog will get up and go over and sit down and gaze in spite of that little ad. He knows his master's voice. No dog ever looks into a phonograph. He did with curiosity. He can't appreciate it because he hasn't got the kind of life that can appreciate it. But a two-year-old baby. We thought at first that our grandchildren were unusual. Because when you play music, they show their little bodies. Then we find out all babies do that. But everybody's like that. That is good into them. They've got it in them to do it. God put them into the rhythm of the universe. Now, I'm not afraid of rhythm. I don't go for Elvis Presley, but I'm not afraid of rhythm. Because the beat of God, the up, down, north, south, east, west, It's God the musician in his universe. And so the little babies are born into the stream of it, as a priest is born into the water, into the stream. And when they're old enough to hear music, they're old enough to smile and closer. Because it's the dance of life that God gives them that kind of music. Now, my brother, God made us to know him in a way that no other priest can know him. He made us to know him to a degree that no other creature can know him, because no other creature has quite the capabilities that man has. Certainly the angels have capabilities. They're holy angels and they obey God. And certainly the seraphim around the throne shine in the fire of God, and they know God. But they don't know God as man will know God when redemption has been completed. For God means that man should be higher than the angels. God made him a little while lower than the angels, but he might raise him higher than the angels. And when it's all over and we know that we are known, we shall rank higher in the hierarchy of God than the very angels themselves. But my brethren, man, by his sin, lost his knowledge. He lost it. I read about it over here in Romans, the first chapter. Because that when they knew God, they glorified him not as God, neither were thankful, but became vain in their imaginations, and their foolish heart was darkened. And even as they did not like to retain God in their knowledge, God gave them over to a reprobate mind to do those things which were not convenient. As one version says, to do this great collapse. So that man, by his sin, lost his knowledge of God. So that now man, though he has the potentiality to know God in a way no creature in heaven can know God, he still doesn't know God because his conduct is unworthy of his high origin, and his heart is filled with a huge emptiness, if you know what I mean. And so that's what's the matter with it. That's why we have these crises all the time. That's why I treasured in this Christ I showed in the recommendation we tested over the immediately less the next man who's elected president will be anti-American. And may turn out to be anti-missionary. Well, what's the matter with it? They told us that science and philosophy and psychiatry and psychology and sociology and all of this to make the world a better place in which to live, and to wish that all men could all be their brothers, each other's brothers. But we're hurting each other more than ever since the beginning. And there's more hatred and more suspicion and more treachery and more fighting and more espionage and more treachery and more telling out whenever there has been since the beginning of the world. What's the matter? It's because man is filled with a vast emptiness. He was created to know God, but by his sin he chose the gutter, and he likes not to have God in his knowledge. And so man is like a bird shut in a cage, or like a fish taken from the water. And so man instinctively craves for the image and misses it, misses the eternal being. This is the life, this is the love, this is the friend. And that's what you never will if you don't know it. Why do 15 kids get into an old banged up car with pipes and hammers and go out on the plow looking for anybody, not anybody in particular, but anybody? Because down in the deep soul of them is the knowledge that sometime they've got to die, that this the world isn't enough, and theirs I don't understand. And so it turns in on them and turns the same and becomes perverted. And like the alcoholic, they choose the gutter and love the gutter. And what does the Bible teach about the now knowing God, the sinner? Well, it teaches that God can be known. It teaches that God has not abandoned the human race. Has he abandoned the angels of sin? Why did he abandon the angels of sin? Because they were never made in the image of God in the first place. They were made more physically capable of moral and spiritual perception. But they were not made in the image of God. Why did not God abandon man? Because man was made in the image of God. And so God gave man a chance and sent a redeemer. How does the Bible teach that man can know God? It teaches that in Christ and through Christ, he is the image of the invisible God, the brightness of his glory, and the express image of his person. Our old father said this about it. I believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, begotten of him before all ages. God of God, light of light, very God, begotten, not made. He is of one substance with the Father, by whom all things were made. And this is what the Bible teaches. It teaches that everything the Godhead is Christ is. Don't listen to the liberals who say God revealed himself through Christ. And listen to the liberals who say that there was just that Christ reflected more of God than other people did. Don't listen to the liberals who say that if one piece of metal might be more radioactive than another, so certain individuals are tuned to God in a way that other individuals aren't. And they are therefore religious geniuses, and that Jesus Christ was the supreme religious genius, catching and reflecting more of God than any other man. Don't listen to that, because all that amounts to insult Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ was not a reflector of deity only, though he was that. He was not a revealer of deity only, though he was that. He was and is and always has been and never can cease to be God, light of light, God of God, very God of very God, begotten, not created. He told that all that the Godhead is, Christ is. He told to know Jesus Christ is to be back at the ancient fountain again. Back at the ancient fountain again. I don't say this is a result of advancing years, because I felt this way when I was converted at 17. I certainly didn't have it developed this far, but I went back to the roots of my being. But I tell you, my brethren, that we've pushed our way on into artificiality so far that it's a wonderful thing, by one wonderful swift act of our souls in faith and prayer, to go back to the ancient fountain of our being and start over again. And there, no God for ourselves, all over again, back where Adam started, back beyond where Adam started, back beyond where the world began, back beyond where the angels began, back at that ancient, glorious, heavenly fountain we call the being of God, the crying God. And in Jesus Christ we go back there. In Jesus Christ we leave all the environs, and we go back to the ancient source of our being. Fixed on this blissful center, rest, O John Newton wrote. Now rest my long divided heart, fixed on this blissful center, rest. And go back at the ancient source of our being, we find the beginnings and start all over. In Christ. That I may know him, said Paul, that I may know him. Now my question tonight is, why should we know Christ so little and know God so little? Well, I'd like to say to you this, that not all of the Godhead can be known. This is third to any of you, it'll be a most wonderful thing for us. Because a real good shaking down is good for Christians sometimes. Getting the shaking them back to where they belong. And if any of you have the idea that you know pretty well all that can be known about God, you're just about to burst. And we warn you, just about 2 more 6-pound pressure and you'd blow. And when you blow, it'll take God a long time to get you back together again. Well, brother, not all of the Godhead can ever be known. Because that being that was capable of knowing all of the Godhead would have to be equal to the Godhead. Just as you can't pour a quart of water into a vessel holding less than a quart, so you can't pour all of the Godhead into a spirit with anyone being less than God. Now I have quoted before what some of the ancient fathers said in arguing for the Trinity. They said, look at it like this. God the eternal Father, who is an infinite God, and his name is love, and he is love. And so the very nature of love is to give itself. And he could not give his love fully to anybody that was not fully equal to him. And so there we have the infant Son, who is equal with the Father. And the eternal Father poured out his love into the Son, who could contain it, and contain all of it, because the Son is equal with the Father. And then said these wise, reasoning old brethren, they said, so the ancient Father to pour his love out on the Son would mean that a medium of communication had to be very close to the Father and the Son, and that was the Holy Ghost. So there you have the Trinity. The ancient Father in the fullness of his love, pouring himself to the Holy Ghost, who is indeed equal to him, and to the Son, who is indeed equal to the Spirit and the Father. So not all of the Godhead can be known by man. The limitless infinite spirit being is called God, filling and surrounding and enfolding and upholding. But all that can be known of God is revealed in Christ. And when Paul said that I may know him, that I may know him, no one may know him, he is not intellectual at all. He don't know God as you know the multiplication table, or know the Morse code, and as a kid experience, so I learned the Morse code. And I could send me three messages, or not too well, but I was working on it for a while, anyhow. Go over the old telegraph instrument. And you can know almost anything. Practically nothing you can't learn. But it's intellectual. And Paul said that I may know him. He did not mean him to be intellectual. He meant by experience, personally and consciously. He meant that I may know God personally, myself. Spirit, touching spirit, and heart, touching heart. And conscious knowledge of God. You know, the old Henry Stuart, I get to heaven and run and hunt some of these old fellows up. I'll be satisfied to sit and just wait for 1,000 years. But after that, if I get up enough courage, I go hunt up some of these dear old brethren. One of them will be Henry Stuart. And Henry Stuart said this, there is a vast difference between hearing a lute sweetly played and merely hearing that one has been played. Now, one thing to hear that there's been a concert, it's another thing to have heard the concert. It's one thing to hear that there has been a planet suddenly discovered, but it's another thing to have gazed on that planet. Now this describes almost all Christians, not all certainly, but a great many, too high a percentage of Christians. They've heard there's a sweet lute that's been sweetly played, but they've never heard it themselves. They know God only by hearsay. And I don't want to be harsh and hard on people, friends, but it's my conviction, a growing conviction with me, that that's what the matter with us now. What's the matter with the church on earth, the gospel church, the believing church. That we tend to know God only by hearsay. Some have never heard of him except by hearsay, and others have heard him and known him, but only faintly. We've heard only faint echoes of God's voice instead of ever hearing the voice of God. But always tell a man or a woman who's been into the presence and come out. There is a vibrancy in the testimony that you don't find anywhere else. I claim I can know as much about a place by reading about it as most people who go there. But everybody that goes and travels abroad and comes back, they always smile at that. If you've actually been there, you know it in a way you can't know if you've only read a book about it. And most Christians have only read a book about God, that's all. They've heard the faint echo of the voice of God. They've seen a reflection of the light of God. They've seen a photograph instead of God himself. And their personal knowledge of God is very slight. And I don't want to hurt your feelings. So I will have asked you, but I would say that I'm afraid that a lot of us here, for all our reputation, we don't know God for himself very much. Church attendance and fellowship and singing and lean on each other all the time. And we have faith and fellowship and religious activity and all the various religious crops and lean on each other. But that's one thing, my brethren. That's one thing. Jesus had that. He had his brethren. He had his work to do. He had his healing, raising from the dead, and opening eyes, and unstopping ears, answering questions, and blessing people. He had that. But he also had a personal knowledge of God that was calm and real and individual. So that when he went into the mountain to pray and waited on God all night, he didn't feel that he was alone. But God was there. You know, modern Christian services, students can do that and go here and go there. And the result is we know God only by his say. We hear of this sweet lute, but we never hear it played for ourselves. When we want things instead of God. The truth, God wants to give himself. God wants to impart himself in his gift. Separated from God, every gift is dangerous. Any gift is dangerous. If I were to pray for all the 17 gifts in the epistles of Paul, the gifts of the Spirit, and I got them all into danger, see. Christian giving, God didn't give himself with them. God wants to give you himself. Didn't I say a while ago? And isn't it true in the scriptures that when God creates an order of life, he creates an environment for that life? And when God made man in his image and redeemed him by the blood of the Lamb back to that image, is not God the environment of the Christian? The very sea we call the ocean is the environment for whales. And the air is the environment for birds. And the earth is the environment for the night crawler and the mole. But the heart of God is the environment for the Christian. And God meant that we should live in that heart of God. And the great grief in heaven is that we want God's gifts and don't want God. And even in the church today, even in the church it's the same. And if God gives you a rose without giving you God, he's giving you a rose with a thorn. And if he gives you a garden without giving you himself, he's giving you a garden with a serpent. And if he gives you wine without giving you God, he's giving you that which you may destroy yourself. Now God wants to give you himself. And you know, we got to receive this modern seeking God for his benefit. What we can get out of God. You write a book, anybody can write a book now. You tell it. Anybody. All you have to do is write a book on 17 ways to get things from God. And you have immediate sale. 14 ways to have peace of mind. And a word over the tongue. How we can bring God to our service. And the printer can't keep up to this book. We work up God for what we can get out of it. And that's the great blight that rests upon us. The great blight that rests upon us. The sovereign God wants to be loved for himself. And he wants to be appreciated for himself. And more than that, that's only part of it, and not even a half of it. The other part is that he wants us to know that when we have him, we have all the rest. Jesus said it. In another way, seek ye first the kingdom of heaven and his righteousness, kingdom of God and righteousness, and all these things shall be added unto you. Why does God forgive sin? He forgives sin because sin is the shadow that stands between him, God, and us. And if God is ever going to know us and we know God, the shadow has to be removed so God forgives sin. Why does God pour out his Spirit on us when we trust him and believe that he will? It's in order that the Spirit, when he comes, will take the things of mine and show them unto you. Why did God answer prayer in order that in answering prayer, he might unveil his own face to us? And why has God given us the Scriptures, that through the Scriptures we might know God? The Scriptures, my brethren, are not an end in themselves. You hear them talked about as though they were an end in themselves. No man can believe more fully in the verbal inspiration of the Scriptures as originally given than I do. But verbal inspiration or any other theory of inspiration, when it makes the Bible an end in itself, is a dangerous thing. Because the purpose of the Bible is not to lead you to the Bible. The purpose of the Bible is to lead you to God. And the Bible is the lattice through which you look and see our beloved gathering lilies with a dew on his hair. As we read in the Song of Solomon. The Bible is the ladder, the Bible is the means of communication, the Bible is the entrance in, the Bible is never an end in itself. If the modern vote is, use God. Oh, the God would raise up somebody that could say it. It could make his church speak. It could make the Orthodox church speak. Bible people, the fundamentalists, the evangelicals, he'd raise up somebody that could make it clear. We've undergone for so long indoctrination and brainwashing, in a kind of truth that makes God to be our servant instead of our being God's servant. And we are trapped on how to pay God sends money. And he does. I'd starve to death the first 2 years of my ministry if I couldn't pay money in or if not. So I believe God sends money, but it's pretty cheap when we get all excited because God sends money. Somebody over in the Balling Valley was praying for money to buy an outboard motor. They needed an outboard motor. Of course they were praying for it. Don't you think they weren't praying for it? And somebody over here heard them and told them they're spending $350 to buy them a motor over here. I believe in that. But that's what you might say. That's down on the level of the routine. There's something grander and higher and finer and richer than that. And if God doesn't give himself over there along with the motor, he'll wreck that motor himself. God wants to give gifts, but every gift he gives, he wants to give himself in gift. And that's the wonder of it, my darling. He wants to give himself. So now it is, use God, use God. Use God to get your job. Use God to give you safety. Use God to give you peace of mind. In heaven, at last. All right. If God is fixing for those who will say, God, I don't know. My heart says, thee, I want thee. My heart is pain, nor can it be at rest till it finds rest in thee. And I'd rather have thee and nothing than to have everything rolling in my way. You can't be sure God making you prosperous, businessman. You can't be sure at all. You're prospering your soul because you tithe. Well, go ahead and tithe. Double, all right with me. I think you should, but your prosperity may not come from God at all. Maybe the economic level of the day in which you live. Maybe you're pretty sharp, cutting corners. Better have God in a dime than have all the riches in the world and not have God with us. God is searching for those who will put beneath the cloud of forgetting. The brother said all the things that ever God has made, for he is a jealous lover and he suffers no rivals. And you don't want anybody to stand in there and take his place or even remotely take it. He wants us to seek him, to seek God. If you're going to go to him, somebody asked him about preaching, and he said, well, let me tell you something. If anybody comes preaching and telling you to seek him, to seek any more of them, more love, don't listen to them. Don't listen to them. The only preacher you ought to listen to is that which says, seek more God. Seek to know the triune God. You can't all know all the Godhead. You can know all the Godhead revealed in Christ to your soul. Infinitely more than you now know. And if the Church of Christ would come back to this, and would get sober-minded and serious and stop fooling, and would begin to seek for God himself, then all the gifts of God would come along with God. And all the blessings of God would come along with God. We want the fullness of the Spirit, we want clean paths, we want a principle within, we want love divine, all love excelling, we want all of that. But if we seek those things apart from God, we've only found a rose with a thorn. But if we find God, then we find all these things, seeing God. Better I say a thousand times, may God, through Jesus Christ, ultimately. You say, I have accepted Christ and I'm converted. Oh, very wonderful, good. That's good. But do you know him? The man Paul had been converted to, and he was one of the world's great Christians when he wrote that I may know him. And that I may know him and the power of his resurrection and the fellowship of his suffering. He made conformable unto his death. He was plowing on and plowing ahead, and it appeared to be that the knowledge of Jesus Christ Yet what we call the excellency of the knowledge of Christ Jesus my Lord, the excellency of the knowledge of Christ Jesus my Lord. And then this is what you and I are here for. Somebody wants to know what the deeper life is. I almost withdraw from the term anymore. I almost shrink from hearing it. Because everybody's talking about the deeper life, but nobody seems to want God. God's the deeper life. Jesus Christ's the deeper life. And as I plunge further into the knowledge of the triune God, my heart moves out into God further, and is less of me and more of God, and the life becomes deepened and strengthened in God. So that this is the next step, that I might know Him. And only thing that keeps me from knowing Him is my enemy. If it is a friend that stands between him and me, that friend is an enemy. If it is a gift that stands between him and me, that gift is an enemy. If it is an ambition that stands between him and me, that ambition is an enemy. If it is a defeat, I had one. And I allow that defeat to get me down and stand between him and me, and to forget that. Forgetting all the things that are past, I plow forward and press on. And if it's a victory that I have back there, that victory stands between me and the knowledge of God. I've got to put that victory behind me. Well, I suppose I might as well stay in bed. I don't know whether anybody knows what I mean. I'm ready by the grace of God, you do. I think some of you do. But dear friends, do you see what I mean? That all of this cheapening of the gospel by making God our church. God running around with a basket giving away treasures. The phony dimes like John D. Rockefeller, and he scrambled for the dimes. Found new dimes, and write facts about it. I found a dime. Had the image of God on it. Wonderful, isn't it? But not compared with the deep knowledge of God Himself. Knowing, you know this knowledge of God, nobody out of you. Nobody can have you out of it. They can come and point a quick angry finger at you and call you every name the law permits. And when they're seized, you'll feel bad about it, but you still know you know God. They can come and argue with you and give you scripture to prove you're all wrong, and when they're finished, you can say, well, you're pretty good at sorcery, but I happen to know God. You got things too late. You're coming to prove I can't, and I met God before you ever came to prove it. So we can know God for ourselves, that I might know Him. The good thing is, some of you are finding Him, I know that. Some of you are plowing through. I've gotten letters, I've gotten phone calls, I have had personal conversations, and I know that some of you are finding the Lord in a new, rich, deep, and wonderful way over these last weeks. And I'm glad. But there, how about the rest? Can't we speak? Now let's pray. Now before we do pray, why we're going to find out if there are those who would say, I want to say number me. Your own longing heart is talking back to you. And the yearning within you is bigger than you are. You're not poor, maybe quite about it all intellectually, but your heart cries to God. And you want to know what Paul means? You want to know what God has revealed and given to the experience of his saints down the years? And you say, pray for me, Mr. Tozer, that I might have the spiritual courage and faith to rise and put behind me and under my feet whatever it is, friendship, or ambition, or hope, or plan, or gift or victory or anything that prevents me from knowing the Lord Jesus. Would you raise your hand here, pray for you? Anybody here, would you say, I do want to know. Put your hand up, they're going to pray. Say, yes, I do. Do I? You want to know, yes, like I ask you. No. You want to know, yes. Glad for the hands that have gone up, now let's have a little time. Oh, Jesus, Lord Jesus,
In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was in the beginning with God. We thank you, Lord Jesus, that when we come to you, we go back to the beginning. We go back as Paul and back as Moses, back as Abraham and back as Adam. We go back to the beginning. The light is kindness, the light of every man. And in thee we see the power. Through thee we know the power. We pray to thee through the justice prayers and mine. In the name of thy Son, Jesus, we pray, Father, that thou wilt take these young people and these older ones and lead them in these pastures and green pastures and through ways that may be rough and hard and even painful and chastening, but lead them, Lord, lead them until all is behind them, everything's behind them. And they put behind them everything, everything. What they were and what they are and what they're proud of and what they're ashamed of and what the victories they've had and the defeats they've had and the mistakes they've made. Oh, we pray to lead these things on and teach them how to look forward and not backward and keep right here. You know, Father, that when we talk about these things, some come because they feel that they'll be given a capsule that they can swallow or a text they can memorize or some one little trick they can do. Oh, Lord God, it is not thus received, but rather by the cultivation of the knowledge of God in Christ Jesus, by faith and humility and prayer and trust and confidence and obedience, and pressing onward until at last the mountaintop appears in view, and up out of the mist we come to the sunlight. Come, Holy Spirit, heavenly dove, come with all thy quickening power. Come, we pray thee, and pray about this Savior's love, that we put in ours. Pray for all of these, and we pray, Lord, for some who didn't request it, prayer for anything that we should have, and who perhaps are this night without even salvation. And we pray for all the churches that are coming, bringing their service to close right now, or will be within a half an hour or so. Bless them all, Lord, and grant these pray thee that every nut may have, which is and that every shepherd might find lost sheep, and every harlot be found from home. For the victory in the church of Jesus Christ this night, we pray thee throughout all this area. If you will just pray, we ask this thing through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Amen.